All right, I like the Calgary Flames, James. Money line plus 140 to win the game. Now, the Flames, at some point, if they want to get serious about this year, if they want to salvage anything, it's got to start right now. They've lost a couple in a row, but they've only played one game in the last several days, so they'll be well-rested and well-motivated. Up against Toronto, who, as you mentioned, have gone to overtime an awful lot as of late. They're still pulling out victories, but they're playing a lot of close games, maybe closer than their record might indicate, and they're starting their backup or third-string goalie, Michael Hutchinson. You mentioned winless in his last three, .850 save percentage. Put all that together, I think the odds at plus 140 are favorable. I like Calgary there.
Now, Mike, you played 10-plus seasons in the NHL. You've seen the trade deadline come and go before. What's the emotions like on that day? Is there a little bit of uneasiness, some excitement, some dread, perhaps?
I mean, it's all the above. I mean, it's a day of mixed emotion. Depending on your situation, you're on a good team, you're getting good players. There's some excitement because your team will get better and have a better chance to win a Stanley Cup. Unless, of course, you're the player that new player is going to replace or bump down the lineup, then you're adversely affected by the move, and it's not so much fun. If you're on a bad team and like Buffalo and get traded out of there, that's exciting. But for the most part, guys like stability, and the prospect of getting traded and switching teams late in the year is not the most fun.
I think you're safe this year. I don't think you're going to get traded, so you can enjoy the trade deadline day like the rest of us.
Never say never. It's not 3 p.m. yet.
Okay. I'll give you that. That is our NHL analyst, Mike Johnson.
When the puck is not sitting directly flat, when it gets up on edge, there are different ways you can shoot the puck and why it might work. I think initially the key is when it's rolling, you want to try to maintain consistent contact with the puck and kind of throw it, almost like a lacrosse shot. Like you're slinging it towards the net. That way you'll get clean contact, but the puck will get off your blade in a hurry, and it also will elevate faster.
Best chance to open the scoring in the scoreless game came from Jesperi Kotkaniemi. Let's take a look at our TSN 5G view, as it's a seam pass that ends up with Jesperi Kotkaniemi right in his stick. How does he miss this? Look at the body movement, rotate himself, flex on his stick. He does everything right, but that puck is actually rolling, and he sails it over the top of Mike Smith, who got quite a bit away from his crease. Fantastic view of how the slot opened up for Jesperi Kotkaniemi on our TSN 5G view. I'm not sure if it even gets to Paul Stastny or not. Here, get the last look at it. There it is, Paul Stastny's right skate, absolutely in front.
Looked a little bit iffy there,
Mike. No. You're allowed to redirect. Okay. You cannot kick. So you can angle your foot, you can shuffle it and slide it and redirect it intentionally. They changed the language as long as you're not kicking it. And that was a really smart redirection. Not surprising, because he's such a smart, savvy, veteran guy who knows that kind of stuff.
I think he knows his game pretty well, because I see him fitting in at multiple different positions. Basically, I look at Nick Foligno as another versatile forward that can play in a lot of different situations, and let him and Zach Hyman kind of be interchangeable. So if you want to start him on the top six and playing on the wing there with Tavares or with Matthews, and then let Zach Hyman move further down and anchor that third line, which was good when he was there, he gives you that luxury. If you want Zach Hyman up on the top six and you want someone who's very defensively reliable, maybe a little bit better in the faceoff circles if Engvall's taking those draws, well, then Foligno could fit down there and he will excel and embrace either role. And so he doesn't have to play with skilled players and scoring lines. He doesn't have to be just a checker. He can do both. And so I think he just builds in more roster flexibility. But I think a lot of it hinges on what they choose to do with Zach Hyman, because Zach Hyman's so important that he can be kind of a poor man's Hyman wherever Zach's not playing.